Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick. I want to do a second video here. I wanted to go back and just 2 days ago, the Lord reminded me of a word He gave me and a vision I had about the rapture. And this is like about 2 or 3 years ago. And I made a video reference to this. But the Lord has just reminded me I've got to go back and find it. Or if some of you guys can find it, you can put the link below. I appreciate it. Maybe it was two different ones. But anyway, this is what happened. I had a vision and a word from the Lord that I was watching Bill Hemmer on Fox News and the rapture happened. It was like Bill Hemmer was announcing about the people disappearing and all that. And, you know, it was like, you know, the rapture, and then also there was all like World War III going on or something. I don't remember all the details because it was just so fast. But it was all this catastrophic stuff going on, like maybe World War III. And then at the same time, he was talking about this world leader, and at the same time was a rapture. It was all like in one thing, you know. And so Bill Hemmer comes on like 9 o'clock in the morning, his show, I think, Eastern Standard Time. And I made a video about this, and I mentioned it. Well, the thing about it is what I want to say is that it's been 2 or 3 years ago, and I forgot about it, and the Lord just reminded me about it. The last 2 days, the Lord's been speaking to me about it. Okay. And the thing is that when I was in the Philippines, I had cable for a little while. I think for 1 year out of the 7 years I was there. And that was the year that this happened. And when I had cable, they had Fox News there. Actually, they were having it as they had it on for like during that time. And then they took it off. It was like one of those preview things on the cable. And they had Fox News. And this is what happened. I had that dream vision, you know, a vision within a dream, or a dream within a dream, about that, about the Bill Hemmer and then what I just told you. But like when I woke up, either that day or the next day, I can't remember because I had to go back and look at my videos. And my prayer journal is in the Philippines, and I started a new one when I moved to the States here. But anyway, I purposely left it because I wanted, I just wanted to start over again and get fresh revelation from the Lord and then, you know, reconfirm what I already had. Anyway, so brothers and sisters, I woke up in the morning there in the Philippines in the before we ever came to the States last year. This was before that, 2 or 3 years ago. And brothers and sisters, I had a night vision. I had a series of night visions. And in other words, I'd already woken up, and then I saw a vision better than I ever do. And I saw it in like watching TV. I saw a vision like watching TV. Clearly, color and vivid, but I was not in it. That's another higher level of vision is when you're like in the vision, like you're there. This was like looking at a TV, so it's a little bit lower level of a vision. Just FYI. But anyway, I saw the face of from the show The Five that comes on at 5 p.m. on Fox News. This is all related to Fox News. This is what the Lord did, which is pretty funny. It was the only Democrat on there who's kind of a, what's his name? He's Bob Beckel. Excuse me, Bob Beckel. He's a Democrat. He used to be on drugs, and he got saved. As a matter of fact, that one, I think, Donna Perina, is saved. All the rest of them are Catholics. They're not born-again Christians. As a matter of fact, I think that Gutfeld is an atheist. You know, as I heard him, you know, talking about how we need a world savior and a world political savior, he's calling for the Antichrist. You don't have enough sense to know it. The rest of them are Catholics. If you listen to what they say, they have all this stuff on there about sex and stuff, because I've watched The Five some since I've been in the States because of that vision I'd had before in the Philippines. There, as a matter of fact, Bob Beckel, even though he's a Democrat, he's like the only true Christian on there. And that's just how ironic things are in the world, brothers and sisters. So anyway, I had this vision, and like a TV screen, and I saw Bob Beckel's face. And the Lord said, this is confirmation to you about the thing about Bill Hemmer, about the rapture and all that, that I just had, either in a dream that night or the night before, I can't remember. So I saw Bob Beckel's face, and this is confirmation to you. And the Lord is like, get up and go in there, and you'll see, because I was just getting up. And so it was 9 o'clock in the morning. Well, in that time of year, it would be 8 o'clock in the morning in the Philippines when I got up. It's 9 a.m. Wait a minute, I got that backwards. 5 o'clock. It'd be 5 o'clock in the morning there, excuse me. But they have a repeat of it. Never mind. I'm getting my time backwards. It's basically 12 or 13 hours difference. It depends on daylight savings time. Anyway, in the Philippines. So it comes on at 5 in the morning in the Philippines and is repeated again later on. So it was the repeat when I saw it, whatever time that was. Anyway, so the Lord had told me to get up and go in there and look. You know, Bob Beckel, the Lord showed me Bob Beckel. That's pretty wild. And then, before I got up, the Lord showed me a second vision of the cover of a book. And I'd seen that book before, and I couldn't remember the name of it. But I heard the Lord say, Church Triumphant, Triumphal Church, or the Church Triumphal. And, you know, so the church, when the rapture happens, the church will be triumphal. And I saw the cover of a book, and I knew I'd seen that book before at the Christian bookstore. And it's like a, you know, elevated throne looking, it's like a throne, and it's elevated and all this. I recognized the book cover, and the Lord told me the church triumphal. And so, of course, that refers to the rapture, too. Even though the book is not necessarily about that. The book is about the church's victory over the world, but the ultimate victory of the church is the rapture. And that's what the Lord was referring to. So I got up, brothers and sisters, and I made a video about this. I got up, I went in there, I turned on the TV, boom, The Five was on Fox News. I started watching it. Then Bob Beckel started saying about him being saved, how he got saved, you know, Franklin Graham. He had talked to Franklin Graham, I think it was, or Billy Graham or Franklin Graham. He got saved, and he had been on cocaine and all this before, and he got into some trouble back in the 70s or 80s, whatever it was, maybe the 90s. Anyway, Franklin Graham led him to the Lord, and he was giving his testimony about Jesus Christ. And then he started talking about how he had been a work for the Peace Corps. He had been in the Peace Corps in the Philippines. You know, of course, he was in the Peace Corps when he was like a hippie dude before he was a Christian. But still, he started talking about how the time he spent in the Philippines, and he loved the people from the Philippines. He was talking about all that. And here I am, in, you know, a missionary in the Philippines. You know, and so I was, you know, that was what the Lord wanted me to see. It was confirmation. So I listened to all that. Then they went on. It was the end of the show. I turned the channel, and I went to the TBN, or one of those Christian channels. There's three or four Christian channels. I went to one of the Christian channels. There was these two older women, and they have like some kind of talk show, and it was boring. I would never watch them. They're just, you know, just talking to me. They're just chit-chatting on there. They're not even talking about the gospel. But I flipped it by there. They were holding up that book with the picture on it, The Church Triumphal by Kenneth E. Hagin, the dad. They call him Dad Hagin, the old man who died 2003. They were holding the book by him, Church Triumphal. And they were talking about it. And this was in like 2010 or whatever. He'd already been dead 7 years. There's a million Christian books, and they're holding up that book and talking about it. And talking about that book. And that, you know, recommended that people should read it. Brothers and sisters, and that's what I saw. So it was a huge confirmation. Okay, and I made a video about that. So it had to be 2011 maybe. Somewhere along in there. And then now, the last 2 days, the Lord has been reminding me about that. As a matter of fact, brothers and sisters, this morning, when I was already up, and the Lord had reminded me yesterday about it, out of the blue, about Bill Hemmer. And it was in my mind all day yesterday. Today, when I was up, and I was going around and all that, because I didn't hardly watch any TV. I turned on the TV, boom, there's Bill Hemmer again. You know, I didn't even think about what time it comes on and all that. I turned it on. I guess that was at 9 o'clock this morning. There's Bill Hemmer's face right in the camera, and he's talking about ISIS and all that stuff this morning. On and on and on about it. So, and it was like, that was what was in my spirit for the Lord. So that's why I'm excited about it. I don't know when the rapture's going to be. I hope it's soon. You know, I've had other dreams where the Lord has shown me that my wife and I would have another child. And I've had that dream twice, and that the child was at least 18 months old in my dream. So, you know, that would have to be at least like 2.5 years from now. So, you know, over 2 years from now. So, you know, but those things I had were really visions from the Lord. Dreams can be dreams. Not all dreams are from the Lord. But a vision is a vision. And it was a vivid visions that I saw. So, brothers and sisters, you know, maybe there's some more to this ISIS thing and all that. I don't know what all. But, of course, ISIS, you know, the other name of ISIS is used. You know, really the worship of the Virgin Mary is really the worship of ISIS. And Horus, you know, I could go into all that. So I'll switch up and start talking about the meaning behind that. So those people who are, you know, running around the internet to and fro looking for rapture visions, go back and get you another cup of milk. Now I'll switch from milk, from wet nursing, to some meat. Okay, so for all the grown-ups, ISIS, you know, the goddess Isis from the Egyptian mythology is also Tammuz. From Babylon, you know, Tammuz supposedly had a virgin birth, you know, had a child after her husband died. Then she miraculously had a child. And, you know, that's what they try to say, that Christianity is copying that story. But in actuality, the devil is already planting that to try to discredit the virgin birth of Christ. Because, of course, when God's, you know, the devil's smart. He knows a whole lot more than we do, okay? So when God said in Genesis 3:15 that the seed of the woman would crush the head of the seed of the serpent, the first prophecy in the Bible, You know, whenever you talk in the Bible or in the world, you know, you talk about a seed. The man is the one with the seed, not a woman. Jesus is the only one that's a seed of a woman because, you know, God is his father. So his DNA is all from his mother, you know, almost, you know, so he's the only one that's born that's the seed of the woman. Everybody else is the seed of a man. So, you know, and Satan obviously knew what that meant when we didn't know what that means. You know, but Satan knew that, hey, that means that this is going to be a virgin birth. You know, that God's going to have a child on earth, the seed of the woman. That God would make another Adam. The Bible calls Jesus the second Adam. That God would make a perfect body, a sinless body, and then he himself would indwell in that body, which he did. God, the Godhead dwelt fully in Christ, the Bible tells us. So anyway, let's see. So Isis is the Egyptian version, really, of the same story of Tammuz. And then Isis's husband was killed by his brother. And I always get those two mixed up, the father and son. There's Horus, and, you know, and the people, they're always kind of interchangeable, the father and son, or the reincarnated. You know, one is, I said father and son. One is the, you know, the man who was married to Isis, her husband. He was killed by his brother because he was jealous. And then she recreated him, found all of his bones. They were scattered in the Nile and put them back together, except for she couldn't find his phallus. His phallus. Go look that up if you don't know what it means. So she made one and put it on there, and then she climbed on, you know, then she had some kind of, you know, supernatural relations with her husband, and then she had a son, you know. And so that's the story of Isis and her husband. And then I can't remember, like I said, there's Horus. One of them is before he was made into a mummy. That's why they mummify the body. They do the mummy thing and all that. It was from that myth, you know, that story they have. So anyway, that's why the Washington Monument is a phallus. And the real, you know, obelisk, that's what obelisk are. The obelisk there in Caligula Square, that's Caligula's horse racing track where the Vatican is now. And then that big phallus there that really came from Egypt. It's a real one from Heliopolis, which is really the Antichrist. Another name for Apollyon is Helios, is another name for Satan. Heliopolis is the city, and in that Heliopolis is the real phallus, you know, it's supposed to be the real phallus of Horus, you know, to create the Antichrist. It was moved by Caligula to Rome. He carried it all the way from Egypt to Rome, put it there, and it just so happens, of course, the Vatican built right there in Satan's place in Rome with that phallus right in front, right there in the front, and then the top of the Vatican is a dome representing the pregnant belly of a human woman. Now, I'm going through this stuff. Those of you who pick up on bits and pieces and, you know, look at other videos, find out about this stuff. The Capitol Dome in Washington, D.C., the pregnant belly of a human woman, as above, so below, with the George Washington Monument, the phallus symbol, creating the Antichrist, just as the Nephilim. As Jesus said, you know, all this studying that I've discovered, and other people have done much research on it, like Dr. Tom Horn, and other people like that, David Flynn, the late David Flynn, people like that. God started me on this in 2009 when he spoke to me and said, the Bible verse, as the days of Noah were, so shall the coming of the Son of Man. As the days of Noah were, so shall the coming of the Son of Man. So, you know, they say, and Jesus even talked about they were eating and drinking and marriage and giving in marriage, and then boom, sudden destruction came. So, you know, the people who are in the carnal mind would sit there and say, whoa, you know, people's going to be getting married, and then boom, you know, the tribulation's going to happen. You know, the rapture's going to happen in the tribulation. But people have been given in marriage and eating and feasting and partying. There's nothing unique about all of those things. That's been going on in the days of Noah. That's going on today. That was going on 1,000 years ago. It was going on 2,000 years ago. That's nothing unique about that. What was unique about the days of Noah? That's what the Lord was asking me. You know, what was unique about the days of Noah? Look at the text. Look at the text. Go back and read Genesis 6. What was happening? The focus is not about, well, people were having a good time and getting married and eating and carrying on and having good times, so God sent a flood to kill them all. It's not what it says. For one thing, they were all in wickedness. But why were they in wickedness? Because the sons of God had left their first estate, Jude tells us. They did not keep their first estate. And that word refers to their body, their glorified angelic body. They gave up that angelic body. They came to the earth just like the two angels that went to Sodom and Gomorrah, just like the angel of the Lord who appeared to Joshua at the Battle of Jericho. Angels are able to come in the form of a man, even as Hebrews tells us that sometimes people have entertained angels unawares. They appeared as people. Angels have done this all the time, and they still do it. They'll appear as a human that needs help, you know, a homeless person, and ask for some money, and, you know, you don't give it to them, and then, you know, that's, you know, God even does things like that, whatever. God can do anything he wants. Just an example. So anyway, that's what was unique about the days of Noah. The Nephilim, the giants, these fallen angels slept with the daughters of men, as above, so below, creating the giants, and then the fallen angels taught, as the book of Enoch, which was in the canon of Scripture for 800 years, then removed. The Jewish scholars lobbied the Church of England and all these places and did all they could and raised all kinds of Cain to get, literally, to get the book of Enoch removed from the canon of Scripture, because it literally points to the Messiah better than any book that was ever been written on the face of the earth. More prophetic, more specific, more exact than anything written in the whole Old Testament. As a matter of fact, if it had not been found in the Dead Sea Scrolls as being written pre-Christ, written in B.C. times, I would say, the book of Enoch was written obviously after the life of Christ, and it's a forgery by someone who's a follower of Christ. And that's what people were saying, and that's why they finally took it out. Those are some of the reasons. Then come to find out, they found it in the Dead Sea Scrolls, written before Christ, with all these specific, exact words all about the Lord. Doesn't matter. You don't need the book of Enoch. It's all in the New Testament, as Jude quotes whole verse, several verses out straight from the book of Enoch. Anyway, so those angels left their first estate, and then they slept with the daughters of men, and then created the Nephilim. And then the Antichrist is going to be one of them. You know, he will be, you know, Jesus was God and man. The Antichrist is going to be Satan and man. He's going to be a fallen angel and a man. It's going to be everything that God does, the devil tries to pervert it into a perverted pattern of that. As above, so below. What God's doing in the third heaven, he wants his people, the church, and the nation of Israel, like Moses, to build the temple after the pattern that God showed him in heaven. God wants us to let his will be done in us and on earth as it is in heaven, the third heaven. And then the devil and his people in the second heaven, the devil wants his people to do his will on earth as it is in Satan's desire in the second heaven, doing all kinds of perversions and bestiality and all this stuff, all the satanic Bible and black masses and whatever, all the things that wicked people might do. Aleister Crowley, wickedest man that ever lived. But I'll tell you, someone is more wicked than him and more powerful than him. Impact on this world is Albert Pike, who was involved in bestiality, is a revered man in Washington, D.C., and from Freemasonry and a co-founder of the Ku Klux Klan, all this other stuff, head of the Illuminati in the United States. Lots of things you study about Albert Pike and Aleister Crowley. You can see all these things, what the devil's message is, what the devil's plans are. Aleister Crowley wrote it, and even before him, Albert Pike, 100 plus years ago, they already wrote down what Satan's blueprint. It's being fulfilled today. I wrote about that in a book too, brothers and sisters, in the book the Lord gave me to write. That's what I wrote about, part of the book, Satan's Plan for the Ages. Anyway, brothers and sisters, all of those things are coming to pass now. It's coming to a head. That's where everything's going, brothers and sisters. To Satan's will being done on earth as it is in heaven. Not the Lord's will, because people have turned from the Lord and rejected the Lord. The fallen church, all the atheists who are anti-God, America going down the tubes, Europe and them already post-Christian nations. Almost the whole world is going down the tubes, going to that Satan's will done on earth as it is in the second heaven. Tribulation period. The height of Satan's glory, his son to rule and reign on earth for 7 years. The Antichrist, kingdom of the Antichrist. Tribulation period. That's the time period that we're facing, brothers and sisters. And of course, just as a disclaimer for those who can't think in the big picture, of course God is allowing it. Of course God is doing this as his own judgment and own punishment. And as you know, you'll hear me say about Obama. Obama at this time is our punishment. We have Obama as a reflection of the people that voted for him. That whatever happens to the United States under Obama is what we have deserved as a country, because God is using it as an instrument of judgment on us, brothers and sisters. He's given the United States what it asked for. Just like Israel said they wanted a king, and God said, I don't want you to have a king. I'm your king. And they demanded a king, and so God told Samuel to tell them, it's a wicked thing you've done asking for a king. Guess what? I'm going to give you the king that you deserve. He gave him King Saul, who was a disobedient big jerk. You know, and then God's man, of course, was David. Just like so after King Saul or the Antichrist, then, of course, God has a king for us, and that's the Lord Jesus Christ when he returns at the end of the tribulation. And we who are caught up to meet him in the air, we are who are with him in heaven during the tribulation at the marriage supper of the Lamb, and we will sup with him and he will sup with us. We will come back with him, as Jude tells us. quoting from Enoch, seventh from Adam, that the Lord will return with 10,000s of his saints. They didn't have millions in those days in the archaic language of Enoch. That the Lord return with 10,000s of his saints, and we will come back and rule and reign with him. Praise God. Straight from the book of Jude. Praise God for all, or from Jude, which is straight from the book of Enoch. God bless you guys. We're going to rule and reign with Christ. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. And to rule and reign, Jesus said, though, he said in his parables, if you're faithful over the things I've given you, over a few things, I'll make you faithful over many things. And if you were not faithful over what the Lord gave you, he will take from you what you think you have. The parable of the talents. The Lord tells that three or four different ways throughout the Gospels. The parable of the talents. So use the talents that the Lord gave you to the maximum amount so that you might have the maximum amount that you are able to handle of ruling and reigning with him when we return. God bless you guys. Love you guys. Keep looking up. Praise God. I hope that we're out of here soon. Who knows how much darker things will get. I do believe the United States will see judgment before the rapture. We will see with our own eyes judgment falling on the United States. False flag, government released Ebola virus. I believe that's probably going to happen. And I believe, you know, and that's in my opinion. I won't say that's a prophecy. In my opinion and in my spirit from the Lord, of course, I believe there will be some tragic attacks. And the first and second city of the United States, New York and Chicago, and who knows what else. And even in the plains of the United States, there these things will be seen. The judgment hand of the Most High God. It's unfortunate, brothers and sisters. It's not, it's bittersweet, as the Bible tells us, like in John. And then I believe it's all on the top of my head. I think it's Ezekiel that we see that judgment of the Lord is bittersweet, because it's sweet in the fact that it's from God, but it's bitter in the fact that it's judgment. But brothers and sisters, may you be hid in the Lord tonight. May you be counted worthy to escape these things that's coming upon the earth and stand before the Son of Man. Luke 21:36. Pray ye always, Jesus said. Always, not one time. Pray ye always that you be counted worthy to escape these things and stand before the Son of Man. And brothers and sisters, that's what I'm doing. And I know I'll never be perfect. I've made tons of videos on all this. You know, dividing grace from hyper-grace, from legalism and all those things. People get off in the ditch on both sides. But the main thing is two things. The Bible says God gives grace to the humble, but he resists the proud. Like the parable of the Pharisee and the tax collector that went into the temple. And the Pharisee was arrogant and boastful and said, I'm glad I'm not like this tax collector, or, you know, a publican. They call them publicans. I'm this and I'm that and I'm so awesome. And then the publican or tax collector didn't even look up. But he hit himself in the chest and looked, you know, stared at the ground and said, forgive me, Lord, I'm a sinner. And Jesus said that man was justified. The second man was justified in the eyes of God. God gives grace to the humble, but he resists the proud. Remember that. God gives grace to the humble, but he resists the proud. And another one, Romans 8:16. I quote it all the time. His spirit, God's spirit, bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. So you know that you're saved, not because what people told you, or even by sitting here saying, on the authority of the word of God, I know I'm saved. And that's true. But the Bible says that when you get saved, your spirit is renewed. You become born again. His Holy Spirit indwells your human spirit. And then he tells us, Romans 8:16, how do you know you're saved? That's the number one question I get asked. It says his spirit, the Holy Spirit, bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. So I know I'm a Christian not because you told me so, or I told myself so, or 1,000 greasy gracers told me that I said a sinner's prayer 30 years ago and I'm saved, or because I kept the Ten Commandments or any of those things, whatever people might try to tell you. His Holy Spirit confirms in my spirit and gives me peace and comfort and wisdom and knowledge to know that, yes, I'm saved. I'm a child of God. He tells me in my spirit from his spirit. That's the only way you know you're saved. God bless.